Thank you so much, choir and orchestra, and I invite you to open your Bibles once again to the book of Deuteronomy. Find chapter number 5, and that is where we have been for several weeks now and where we will continue to be over the next several weeks. Deuteronomy chapter number 5. Years ago, a man by the name of Nicholas Van Hoffman wrote a piece, a little article, and I clipped that out, put that in my file. And I want to share that little piece with you today. And what caught my attention when I was looking at that article was the title, and the title was The Mush God. And he wrote, "The Mush God has been known to appear to millions on golf courses. He appears to politicians at ribbon-cutting ceremonies and to clergymen speaking the invocation on national television at either the Democratic or the Republican conventions. The Mush God has no theology to speak of being a cream of wheat deity. The Mush God has no particular credo, no tenets of faith, nothing that would make it difficult for believer and non-believer alike to lower one's head as the reverend, the rabbi, the father, or so-and-so leads in an innocuous, harmless prayer. For the God of public occasions is not a jealous God. He in no way is an offended God over anything. He is the God of the rotary, the optimist, the protector of the good old boy system. The Mush God is a serviceable God whose laws are chiseled not on tablets but written on sand. They are open to amendment, qualification, and erasure. There is a God, this is a God that will compromise with you and make allowances. The Mush God makes no demands and issues no commands." Now, this morning, as we continue our series, The Hope for America, The Home, in which we are looking at God's Ten Commandments and applying those Ten Commandments as the fix to the broken family, which is the fix for a broken nation, I want to talk to us today from Deuteronomy 5, verses 6 through 7, on the title, One God Per Family. And in case you have not figured it out yet, this God is not the Mush God that was spoken of in this article. In Deuteronomy 5, verses 6 and 7, the Lord says, before the children of Israel are entering into the land of Canaan, the promised land, he repeats these Ten Commandments given in Exodus 20, and he says, "I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. You shall have no other gods before me." Now, what is so interesting to me is that before God said anything about how his people were to live, he explained to them who he was. Before he said anything about their behavior, he talked about their belief, and especially what it was that they were to believe when it came to believing in God. You see, the Mush God's not very big when it comes to behavior modification, but the Bible God is very big when it comes to modifying our behavior. I read several years ago about a group of seminary students, and they were given a particular assignment by their professor, and he told them that he wanted them to gather in groups. He wanted them to study the Ten Commandments, and then he wanted them to come back and to present what they thought the order of priority ought to be for these Ten Commandments. And so they did their study, they compiled all their research, and when they had concluded their study, they put the commandment about murder as being the first one of importance, while they took the first one about having no other gods before me, they took that one as the last in priority. Now, I'm grateful that God wrote the Ten Commandments and not the seminary students, because this is the single most important commandment that is given. Dr. Charles Hodge, I have some of his books at Princeton University. He said of this commandment, "The duty to which we are directed by this commandment is the highest duty of man," end of quote. And so when it comes to teaching our children in the home about the Ten Commandments, we better focus on this one because it is the highest one when it comes to priority. What I want to do this morning is I want to take this one commandment, you shall have no other gods before me. I am the Lord your God that brought you out of the land of Egypt. I want to take it and I want to divide it into two different categories. And first of all, I want us to consider simply the theological implications. What are the theological implications of this commandment that God gave not only to them, but God has given to us as well? Well, when God says that I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, you shall have no other gods before me. When God says that, God declares three things about himself. What is it that God declares about himself that we ought to know? Number one is that he is the God whom Scripture declares. He is the God whom Scripture declares. There is no other God. And when he declares himself as I am the Lord your God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, what God is declaring is his sovereign supremacy over all other false gods. When he says, I'm the God that brought you out of the land of Egypt, what he's saying is that I am the God that sent the 10 plagues upon the land of Egypt to get the attention of Pharaoh who was holding you in bondage and in captivity, that I am God over all of those pagan deities in the land of Egypt. Now, how do we know that there is only one God? It is because Scripture declares it. Scripture says it. Did you know that there is nowhere in the Bible where God tries to prove his existence? Not one place. He just declares his existence. That's what he does here. That's what he did in Genesis 1:1 when he said, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. So God never tries to prove his existence. He just simply declares his existence. And parents, I want to tell you, that's the number one lesson in life you got to teach your kids and begin early is that there is only one God. You see, it's your responsibility as a parent, my responsibility as a grandfather to make sure that my grandchildren, that they know that. And so nowhere does the Bible try to prove the existence of God. As a matter of fact, did you know that the Bible only devotes one verse to the atheist, and that is just one part of one verse. The Bible never tries to prove his existence. It never tries to argue theism versus atheism. You'll not find that in the Bible. Psalm 14a, just one part of one verse. God said, the fool has said in his heart, there is no God. You realize it does no good to try to argue with a mindless fool who has already made up their mind in spite of the evidence concerning the existence of God. They've already made up their mind that they're not going to believe in God. And the fool's problem is not that he can't believe that there is a God. He won't believe that there is a God. The fool has said in his heart, his problem's not in his mind, but his problem is in his heart. And one of the easiest things, parents, that you can do is to teach your child about the existence of God because every child comes into this world predisposed to believe in the existence of God because the Bible says in Ecclesiastes chapter 3 and verse 11, God's put eternity in every heart and in every soul. And so that child is predisposed to believe in the existence of God, and our responsibility is to lead them and help them believe in the right God. Because what we're going to discover today is that there are a lot of false gods out there. And so when God says, I am the Lord your God that brought you out of the land of Egypt, what is God saying? He's declaring that he is the God whom Scripture declares. Number one, he is the God whom creation displays. Not only the God whom Scripture declares, but also the God whom creation displays. Y'all all know Psalm 19. The heavens have declared the glory of God, and the firmament showeth forth his handiwork. You look up in the skies, and it declares that God created this. You go to Romans chapter 1. The Bible says there is enough evidence in the creative world of God to declare that God is. Do you realize that the greatest declaration for the Creator God is not seen in the stellar heavens, but it's seen in the human body? I mean, how else do we explain the wonders, the intricacies of the human body and how it works, other than the fact that there was a creator of that body? And I realize this sounds rather elementary, but moms and dads, you need to teach kids that. Because if you send your children to school expecting the public school to alert your children where they came from, they're going to be taught monkey mythology. You know, you send your kids out into public education, and what are they going to learn? That they are going to learn that they came from some lower form of life. They're going to learn that, you know, they came from the primordial ooze somewhere. But you need to teach your kids that ain't so. You need to teach your children that they were fearfully and wonderfully made. The imago Deo, the image of God. They were created in the image of God. And God has a divine purpose and a plan for their life. You know, every single kid ought to know that they came out of the womb like they are, who they are, the way they are, created by a loving God who has a plan and a purpose for their life, who gave them certain and unique skills and abilities to be able to accomplish whatever the plan of the Creator is for their lives. Friend, I want to tell you, that'll do wonders for their self-esteem to realize that they didn't come from some lower life form, but they came from the hand of the living and loving God who created them in His image. So within that little phrase, I am the Lord your God. It's the God whom Scripture declares, the God whom creation displays. Pastor, you realize that science disagrees with that. Well, let me tell you something about the scientists. Did you know that all the scientist can know is what he knows by observation? As Christians, we know what we know by revelation. And friend, I'll take revelation over observation any day and time. And whenever there is a contradiction between science and theology, which is not very often, listen, go with God, believe God, side with God, because what he tells us by revelation. But thirdly, I believe that within this little phrase, I am the Lord your God, we see the theological implication that he is the God whom redemption demands. Now, what do I mean by that? When we read this where the Lord says, I'm the God that brought you out of the land of Egypt, what we have there when we go back and study that text in Exodus chapter 12, we have what we call a biblical type. What is a biblical type? A biblical type is a reality that prophetically points to a greater reality. And what was it that happened in Exodus chapter 12, the night before this God delivered them out of the land of Egypt? You remember God had told Moses that night, here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to send the death angel across the land of Egypt. And I want your people to do this. I want them to take a lamb, slaughter that lamb, offer that lamb as a sacrifice. And then I want you to take the blood of that lamb and I want you to put it on the doorposts and the lintels of your home. And when the death angel passes over and sees that blood, you'll be redeemed. You'll be spared. You'll be saved. You'll be delivered. And so because of their obedience, listen to the demand of God to sacrifice that lamb and put the blood on the doorpost, they were redeemed. They were delivered. They were set free. And just in the same way, when you and I, when we respond to the demand of God, which is to repent of our sin and put our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, we are redeemed by the blood of not a sacrificial lamb, but the Lamb of God who came to take away the sins of the world. And the point I'm making is, parents, that's what you've got to teach your children. They've got to grow up knowing that sin has to be punished, that sin carries guilt, and it has to be dealt with. And there's only one way it can be dealt with, and that is through the sacrifice of the Lord Jesus Christ. They've got to be taught there aren't many ways to God. There's only one way to God, and that is faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. So we see the theological implications, but we also see the practical application. Now here is what I want to try, God help me, and attempt to do. In this particular point, I want to talk about some things that we've got to teach our children, and we ought to do it often, and we ought to begin early. Now, there are a few things that I agree with the Roman Catholic theologian and educator, Francis Xavier, but I believe he was spot on when he said, "Give me the children until they are seven, and afterward, you can give them to anybody." What was he saying? He was saying what we put in their hearts and in their minds in those formative years up until the age of 7 years old are extremely important. I want to tell you the things that I learned from my grandmother in those years, I can go back and I can remember today. Much of what she taught me then shaped who I am right now. And so he says, begin early, teach it often. And what is the main thrust of what is being taught here? That we are to put God first. And friend, I want to tell you, as parents, we're not living out what is being taught here. It's going to be almost impossible to teach it. And so we teach it not only by what we say, but we teach it as well by how we live. So what is it, if we're going to get this, if we're going to teach this, and if our kids are going to learn this, there are two things that we've got to understand. Number 10 is the competition that we face. We are talking about teaching our children that we must put God first in our lives. But friend, I want to tell you, we got to know something about the competition that we face in trying to teach our children that. Let me give us just a very brief, quick history lesson. After 400 years of slavery, the Israelites were finally set free at last. They were delivered from the harsh rule of the Egyptians by the mighty hand of God. And you go back and you look at that deliverance and you see that it was dramatic and it was miraculous and it was total. But now as they were about to enter into the promised land, they were about to face a threat to that freedom that God had given to them. Think about their history, wandering through the wilderness for the last 40 years. These Israelites had not faced much competition when it came to their allegiance to God. But things were about to change as they entered into Canaan. Now they were about to really be challenged as far as their total allegiance to God was concerned. You see, God knew that they would be easily seduced by these earthly representations of the Canaanite deities that they were about to face and the promises of temporal satisfaction that they gave. You go back and you study all these Canaanite deities that they were about to encounter. You realize they had a god for almost everything, and every one of those gods promised some kind of a temporal satisfaction. And that would be seductive to the Israelites, and that would produce, I believe, great competition as far as their allegiance to God was concerned. Because the Canaanite deities, it was all about what these gods could do for you. It was never about what you could do for these gods. And that is where all of that false religion differed from the religion in which the Jewish people had been taught. And so God wanted his people to understand and know that their freedom demanded an exclusive relationship with him. And in no way could their lives coalesce with all of these pagan deities. I mean, they created a deity to solve every problem. If their crops were withering, drying up, they just appealed to the rain god. If the land was, you know, too wet and they needed some dry weather, they appealed to the sun god. If they needed a good harvest or wanted children, they appealed to the goddess of fertility. But I know what you're thinking right now. But Pastor, now wait a minute. These were primitive people. Man, these were uneducated and they were unlearned people. After all, we are sophisticated Americans. I mean, if we need to water our grass, we just turn on the sprinkler. I mean, if we need food, we don't appeal to some fertility goddess. We just go down to Publix or Winn-Dixie and get some food. Now, friend, you listen. Our gods may not be made of metal and stone and wood, but I'm telling you, secular America trifles in all kinds of false gods. And Christian Americans get sucked into the worshiping of these false gods. Secularism, though, takes a more subtle approach, doesn't it? But did you know, dear friend, that whatever takes first place in your life or mine has become our God? Whatever is the source of our self-worth has become our God. Whatever it is that we give ultimate consideration to in making decisions has become our God. It could be for a man his job. That's where he finds his value. That's where he finds his self-worth. He is willing to offer up all kinds of sacrifices for this God. He is willing to sacrifice his health, his family, his ethics, his moral standards. He's willing to sacrifice all of that just to rise up a little higher on that ladder in that job. That job's become that man's God. For a woman, it could be her social status. And so she just snubs and ignores old friends that can't help her get in that certain club or that certain organization. To the teenager, it could be that peer group. That peer group that is popular and they want to be a part of that group. And that peer group has become that teenager's God. Friend, do you realize we can put only one thing in the top slot of our priority system? Only one. And for people saved by the grace of God, God Himself has to sit in that top slot. You know, there are three well-known and very attractive false gods in secular America that God's people get sucked into all the time. We dress them up. We make them look good and attractive. I think one of those more popular false gods is the god of position. You know, one must have this to be successful in this life. And so the driving force behind this god is that we want to get in a certain position where others will value us and look up to us because of that position in which we find ourselves. Now, friend, you think about just how early kids learn this. They want to be the quarterback on the football team. They want to be the starting point guard on the basketball team because they run the show. They want to be the class president. Now, friend, as parents, we need to teach our kids, you know what? There is nothing wrong with these things as long as you are not looking for your self-worth in these things. That can be only found in God Himself. He is the only one that can give you that which you're searching for. There's the false god of position. There's that false god of possessions that we all struggle with. Got to have a bigger house, faster car, nicer wardrobe. And you just think about how our Christian kids, how that this affects them when they see the value that society places on possessions. Friend, we got to teach them what Jesus said. Jesus said, a person's life does not consist in the abundance of things that they have. Teach your children the value of what is really valuable. What is valuable? A relationship with God. What is valuable? A life lived out bearing the fruit of the Spirit, of love and joy and peace and goodness and gentleness and faith. I'm just of the opinion that if we teach our kids these things, you'll never find what you're looking for in position. You'll never find it in possessions. If we teach them that, one day they're going to rise up and call us blessed. I think there's the false god of power. Power. The world says that you gauge your success by how many people say how high when you say jump. Power. Oh, if I can just have the power. I think that we teach by example to our children what we model in our home. That power is a terrible god. Let me ask you, dads, if I were to ask your children today, describe the leadership style of your dad, how would they respond? Would they say he's a loving leader or a power monger? You do as I say. You jump when I say jump. All authority in heaven and earth, it belongs to me. How would they gauge your leadership style? I remind us that Jesus said that's the leadership style of the world. Jesus said in Mark chapter 10 that the leaders of the Gentiles lord it over you. But you're not to be like that. I've called you to be a servant leader. And even Jesus himself said, I have not come to be served, but to serve and to give my life a ransom for many. Dad, are you a loving leader or are you a power monger? Did you know that even the most precious gifts from God can become a false god if we put it in a position where only God himself should be? For example, our family can become a false god. I love my family. I'm committed to my family. But my wife will tell you she's number two in my life, not number one. The kids are number three. It's God, my wife, my children, my church. And I'm number two in Karen's life. I'm not number one in Karen's life. But if we're not careful, our families will revolve around our kids, our grandkids. And they take a position that only God himself needs to occupy. That's what the Bible is saying. I am the Lord your God. You shall have no other gods in a position where only I can sit in your life. So I think that there's family. That's a great gift, but it can become a false god. Did you know that even Sunday church can become a false god, putting it where only God should sit? What I mean by that is, why do I come to church? Well, do I come to church just to check off the box? Do I come to church to be seen? Do I come to church because, you know what, I think if I do, it might help my business and people will have more respect for me because they know that I am at church? Or do I come to church, whether I'm a deacon, a staff member, a teacher, a leader, do I come to church because I want to hear a word from God? And I want to worship Him. Even Sunday church can become a false god when it replaces God Himself. Did you know that even the Bible can become a false god when it takes the place that where only God should be? What do I mean by that? If I get more impressed with how much of the Bible I know rather than how much of it I'm practicing, amen or oh me, it's become a false god. Oh, I know so much. Man, I can outline all of the prophecy stuff on the whiteboard for you. Man, I know about all of the end time prophecy. Man, I just know so much, but how much are we doing? Has our very Bible become a false god, putting it in a place where only God should be? So you see the competition we face. We have a serious and a difficult task as parents in teaching our children this. But then secondly, the questions that we need to answer. What are the questions that we need to answer? Number one is, why must God be first? Why must God be first? You know, if we put ourselves first, that's selfishness. If we put God first, that's logical. Why should we put God first? Because He says, I am the Lord your God. Who is God? God is seated on the throne of the universe. God is the sovereign authority. God is the supreme one. That's why we put God first. But friend, I'm afraid that in an opportunity to teach them about the greatest wonder there is, and that is a God who sits on a throne that spoke and created a world and raised the dead and walked on water and cast out demons and all that other stuff, that same God has come down to have a relationship with them. Stop and reflect. Regain your wonder. And then secondly, stop and remember. Stop and remember. What did God say? I'm the Lord your God. I'm the God who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. Stop and remember. God told Israel, listen, you need to remember. Remember my action on your behalf. Remember, I'm the one that gave you your freedom. Remember that you are no longer slaves because of what I have done for you. They owed everything they were to God, and so do we. You see, dear friends, our allegiance to the one to whom we are indebted for every good gift, that allegiance ought to be absolute. Let us remember the mercy and the grace of God. Where would you be today without the grace of God? Where would you be today? Where would you be today? Where would you be today? Where would I be today? Without the mercy and the grace of God, where would we be? Ephesians 2 said we were dead in our trespasses and sins. We walked according to the course of this world. We were slaves to the prince of the power of the air. But God came down in Christ, reached down in mercy and grace, made us alive in Jesus. That's why we must allow Him to be number one in our lives. I serve on the Board of Trustees at the Baptist College of Florida. I've been the chairman of that board a couple of times. I take that job seriously because I love my college. And every year, the beginning of every year, As a trustee, I have to fill out what is called a conflict of interest form. And there are exclusivity clauses all throughout that form that I've got to fill out. And basically what it's saying is, in light of my relationship with the college, there can be no competing loyalties. There can be no contractual obligations with other organizations that would compete with that loyalty. Friend, when God saves us, exclusivity in our relationship with Him is paramount. He doesn't welcome, He doesn't accept competition. He is the Lord God alone. And there shall be no other gods before Him. So my challenge is, let's live like that. Let's teach our kids the truth of that. Would you stand, please? Heads are bowed and eyes closed.